correlation between words released and the faith process. In other words, they don't see how you have to say something for faith to be activated. Am I expressing that kind of the way that y'all, we feel that it is for most people? We feel that words don't have to be released in order for the faith process to be completed. We feel like we can do it silently. We can meditate. I mean, we can just muse over it or to reflect on it.
That's a part of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know it's a part
but
of it.
But that's not the totality. Mm-hmm.
Now, that type of reflection, just musing over, just reading over, glancing at it, and sometimes we just look at it, you know, for 15 or 20 minutes, just read something, but we never give any kind of verbal expression to it. That type of exercise will actually give you the capacity for faith, but it won't actually build the faith in itself. Because if people get a whole lot of head knowledge and it's not heart knowledge, it will never work. You hear everybody agree? And how do you convert head knowledge into heart knowledge? You have to what? Feed your heart. Because when you feed your heart, the Bible says out of the abundance of your heart, your what? Your mouth will speak.
In the process of feeding your heart, what is feeding your heart?
You're feeding your heart, all right? Feeding your heart is actually releasing words. Amen. Finding a way that you can get the Word of God established in your spirit so that you can take that word that have been what? Deposited in here, which has become alive in here, and you speak it, because ain't nothing going to happen until that word becomes alive down here. Up until that point, it's going to be what? Head knowledge, or we call it, giving mental assent. So by reading things softly, see, faith comes by hearing, and many times we feel that hearing Brother Copeland, hearing Brother, who else? Brother Hagin, hearing the teachers, hearing the preachers, is the way that you get faith in your heart. But I think that is a way that you get more information. But I think that in order for you to get it into your heart, you're going to have to work with that word yourself. You're going to have to do something, right? And I think more of feeding, rather than the evangelists or the famous teachers feeding my heart, I think I'm the one that's supposed to what, feed my heart. I receive what they say, then I begin to what, feed that to my spirit. In other words, I got to tell my spirit the same thing that they are what, saying. I got to tell my spirit that. And when your spirit, amen, gets that message, then it's going to be what? It's going to be energized and impregnated, and life is going to what? Be, amen, established in your what? Spirit, life and energy. And then when you begin to what? Speak that word out of your mouth, then it's going to have some what? It's going to have some power. It's going to have some power. But when you first start speaking something, it's not going to have that much power or hardly any. And that's the reason why sometimes people get discouraged, because they haven't really what? They haven't fed their spirit enough in order for the power and the anointing to be deposited down there, so that when they begin to what? Speak it out of their what? Spirit or their heart. So Jesus, you know, always, he said, what, the word I speak, they are what? Spirit and life. But he was consistently, what, agreeing with God in his confession. He says, I always say what my Father tells me to say. I always do the things that are pleasing. You know, my word, amen. Amen. The word that I speak, they're spirit and they're life. Okay, anybody else got So that's the reason why we stress. Now, I was thinking the other day, this book here. Okay, now, y'all can help me out here. When a new convert comes into the church, we know what condition they're in, right? Everybody, you know, we know. And if we haven't really made a practice of feeding our heart with our mouths, then, you know, we probably might be discouraged with the progress that we have been, that we have made in the kingdom of God. All right, on page 2, number C, he says, we bring into the kingdom of God an inferior thought pattern.
Wasn't that page 2?
C under 2. 2 under C, okay. We bring into the kingdom of God an inferior thought pattern. We came to God with a messed up man. Our mind has to be what? Transformed before we what? Can experience God's best. Now, I feel so sorry for like when people, like new converts come in sometimes and just listen to them talk and to see where their interests are, where their values are. And you know that it's a long road, right, in order for their mind to become what? Renewed. And so where do you start with people like that? When you're trying to elevate their belief, you're trying to get them to develop a new image of themselves, when you're trying to get them to a level of believing where at least they can get saved and filled with the Holy Spirit and get delivered. So what can you do in order to help them to come to a point where they can receive the basic things that God has for them? Okay, anybody have any idea?
I think Bible study.
All right, Bible study, okay. Everybody agree with that? Okay, we can put them in a separate Bible study, or we can just let them come to church.
Oh, we need some guidance and help.
Yeah,
help, teach them.
They need some personal help.
Yeah,
do
both.
Let
them know how to have
I was younger, but we all understood we were supposed to get saved and all that. But really, until I really got here, and it was broken down. I mean, even in the latter years, you know, I had a better understanding of God's, what Him going to the cross meant. I mean, it's not about how good I am or how bad I am. It's about His mercy and grace and Him dying for us, sending His Son, that we didn't have to pay for anything. So I think for me, that's something that I would really stress to them so they can understand, because most people do think they're not enough. Or I'll never be enough, some people believe that. And then when I was broken down, about, I mean, it was nothing. Pay for nothing. I'm not going to pay for nothing. I mean, now after I become saved, then I have, you know, some things that I have to do and continue to do to walk in His will. But for me, that was a great thing because, like I said, even being here in the beginning, I learned more. And even the latter years, my understanding became more complete because you took the time to break it down to us. I mean, from the beginning to the teen, all the way up. And that had never been done for me. So I think that's really significant. They know that it don't matter what you've done or
haven't
done.
Okay, that's good. Amen. That is so true. And new people, what do they need first? Do they need to the gospel first? Do you have to get them ready for the gospel or deal with them where they are? And then from that point, the gospel. Y'all agree? Have to kind of deal with them if they're going through some, name some things that people coming to the kingdom that they're going through.
And showing love, because some people have never had love.
Okay.
I mean, unless it was the wrong kind of love. So I think that's important too, for them to know somebody's truly concerned and it don't cost nothing. I'm concerned because I'm supposed to be concerned because I'm one of God's children. You know, that to me is immense to some people that have never.
So to show love is that you kind of identify with them at whatever level or point that you find them, right? You try to deal with them at their point of view. Everybody agree with that?
The majority of people came into the church, Pastor, based on something that might have happened or occurred in their life at right. that moment.
Right.
And okay. whatever that need was,
right.
that's probably what drove them here.
Right.
So we have to be able to meet them right there and understand what they're going through at that point.
That's right.
And let that be our guiding point to try to help them through that situation.
There you go. That's what some diaries are showing.
Exactly.
But sometimes we want to get them saved real quick, fast, so we can put another star in our family. Initially, I think that we have to meet people at their point of view. Okay, and then also, I think Pastor, that once we can, okay.
I was saying, but also, you know, the individual convert, when they normally get saved, they are so thirsty and hungry for the things of God.
Yeah, right.
So if a person has that hunger and that thirst for knowledge, mm-hmm. then all we have to do is encourage them to increase that hunger for it. Because, I mean, I think God has placed in each one of us a thirst and a hunger for knowledge,
mm-hmm. right.
in which we have to find it in different places.
Right.
I mean, the Bible is our source,
right.
and we need teachers to walk us, to help us get through it.
Right.
But if we can encourage those newcomers to thirst and hunger for mm-hmm. the knowledge of God,
mm-hmm.
then
mm-hmm.
God will take them through the steps that they need to take.
Right.
But they got to have that thirst. They got to have that hunger. They got to have that drive to propel them to keep doing it.
Right.
Because without that, they won't be motivated.
Right. I think that when people are going through a crisis or problem, I think that deep down within there is a hunger for reality,
mm-hmm.
the things
mm-hmm.
of God. But many times they kind of misconstrue how to get this hunger or this feeling that they have on the inside, or that thirst, actually fulfill a quest. And so that's where we have to come mm-hmm. in and begin to kind of lead them. So I think that the gospel will definitely come into play probably after you show them that the only way that this need can be what man or this desire can be what fulfilled is going to have to be what turning to God. He's the desire of all ages, and I think everybody desires God, but many times people don't understand that thirst or that hunger that's crying out on the inside of them. So they're going here trying to find an answer, going over here doing this and doing the other thing. But deep down in their heart, the hunger is what? A desire for God.
Yeah.
Okay, but the gospel is the thing that quenches that, and receiving Christ is the thing that brings fulfillment and peace. But after a person is saved, then you have to start working on deprogramming them, and renewing their mind. And that's the biggest challenge. Because, you know, it goes way, way back. They've been programmed. All of us was what? Programmed.
All of us.
Man. Some of that stuff ain't still, you know, still prevailing in our life. But we have to. Now, I was thinking that the first thing that I like to kind of deal with people about, because they can't understand a lot of the deep truths that we confess, that I like to start people off with just simple confessions, because they are releasing words that's consistent with the Word of God. And that's going to begin to change their mindset gradually. It's going to start the process of mind renewing right away. And that's on page one. Once they get saved, maybe they'll feel and maybe they'll not feel, I'm a new creature, predestined for greatness. We're trying to change the way that they see themselves on the inside. You think by releasing that, see, any positive confession is not going to bring a change in a person's thinking. See, there is a positive confession, and then there is a biblical confession. Anybody know the difference between a positive confession and confessing the word? A positive confession. Is there a difference between?
Confession is based on the word of God. A positive confession just could be in the natural, but it don't have to have no spiritual underlying information. It's like some people look in the mirror and they say, I'm beautiful, or I'm a good person. I mean, but that doesn't really have anything to do with spiritualness necessarily.
It's just the affirmation.
Right. So there's a difference between a positive confession and confessing the word. Person can say that the blessing, okay, is this a positive confession? The blessings of the Lord make it me rich and added no sorrow.
Yeah, that's positive.
Okay.
And biblical.
Yes,
and biblical. Okay.
And biblical.
Okay, now watch this right here. I believe that the blessings of the Lord will make me rich and add no sorrow. I believe the word of God will make me rich.
That's not positive.
That's an affirmation.
Yeah, I believe it will. It will. A positive is it has to be in the now.
Okay, that's not a faith statement.
No, that's what I'm trying
but
to
it is a kind of a positive. You know, I believe the word of God will. How will rich be rich?
It will.
Will it work?
That's positive.
Does that work? Does it work?
Huh?
I mean,
that won't work.
A positive, will it work?
Huh? No.
A positive statement, will it work?
If it's not based on the word of God, it won't.
Wait a minute.
See, in order for a confession to work, a faith state, a faith confession, it has to be in the now.
That's what I say.
I believe that by his stripes I will be healed.
I am. I believe.
Okay. It has to be in the now.
Okay, it has to be in the now.
In the now.
Okay. That's a positive statement. I believe that I'll be healed. That's pretty positive.
It's not
based on the word. It's not a faith statement. So therefore, God can't bring that to pass because it's not a faith statement.
Okay, if you say I'm healed by his stripes.
Yeah, by his stripes,
I'm healed by his stripes.
Okay.
That's
awesome.
That's present.
Yeah, present.
Okay, let me challenge you again. Okay, is it wrong to say I am, when you don't have no money, you say I am rich. I'm rich. When you're broke, I'm rich.
Is it broke?
Or either I'm well when you're sick.
Wait a minute. You say, wait.
I am well.
Let's go back.
Okay.
You said when you don't have any money.
Yeah.
Is it wrong to say what?
I'm rich. I have money.
And you broke? And you don't have a penny.
Right, don't have a penny.
Brother Wayne answered that.
Been there, done that. I think he can say it.
I think if you speak in faith. Okay. I think if you're thinking in faith, that's all. I think it's your mindset. If you're saying that in faith, because you know it's not manifest in your hand,
mm-hmm.
but you're saying that in faith.
Mm-hmm. So it's a positive statement, okay.
Yeah.
But is it a.
It's not a positive statement, but it's not a statement of truth.
But that's a lie, right?
It's not a statement of truth.
Well, that's just like Abraham. God told him that he would be a father of many nations, and Abraham was, I'm a father of many nations. I'm a father of many nations. So he didn't have it, but yet he confessed that he heard God say that he was a father of many nations. So if you take it in context of being rich, when Christ said we're rich, according to his riches and glory. Okay.
Right. So you can say I'm rich.
Yeah, I can say I'm rich.
Okay.
According to Jesus Christ. Yeah, according to Christ. Yeah, or according to the word.
It's in the spirit realm. Yes, you know, so you are that right.
Right, it's just in the legal, in the reality stages.
But not actually.
It's not manifested. So this is the way that you can make it a faith statement. You say, I believe that by His stripes I'm healed. I believe that by His stripes. Mm-hmm. So that's different than said by His stripes I am healed, right. Or I am healed when you're sick is not really a factual statement. So I think that you need the word I believe,
yeah,
according to God's word, right, that by His stripes.
And so
I'm
see
healed.
If I said I'm rich, mm-hmm, and I don't give a penny to my name, I'm broke. Then Sister Shirley may say, "Oh, Sister Hill is rich. I'm gonna go and borrow some money from her." And so when she comes to me, I'll say, "Hey, I'll do it."
But you know, sometimes we say that all things are ours. You know, now, what are some of the things you can name? You know, sometimes they call us name it and claim it.
Name and claim it.
Blab it and grab it. What do y'all think about that?
Blab it and grab it. That's the way it's set up.
Okay.
Life is set up that way. I mean, because the words create the pictures, and you see the pictures, yeah, and then you're thankful for what you're seeing, and you're believing, and you don't even have it, so. That's the way it's set up.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree with him. That's the way it's set up. But the way it's turned around is kind of sort of like a comedian-like approach. Grab, you know, name and claim and grab it. But it is. Mm-hmm. That's what.
Well,
it
the
is.
Truth is, you can name it and claim it only if God names it and claim it. If mm-hmm. God names it,
right,
you can claim it. Mm-hmm. But if God doesn't say you can have this, okay, I don't care how much you what claim it.
There you go.
It's not gonna.
But that makes sense.
Yes,
because I know before I had my house built, I would tell people I wanted what I wanted in the house, mm-hmm, and then I would always say that, but I didn't necessarily want a new house. I said I just want more space and blah blah blah. And then all of a sudden, it's like the Holy Spirit, and I didn't think about it until later, because it just became so like on target for me. It was the Holy Spirit speaking to me. All of a sudden, I said, just one day, I said, I'm not gonna keep saying that, because God might be desire for me to have a brand new house. I'm not going to mm-hmm. limit him. Mm-hmm. And that happened. I ended up having a brand new house built. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't like I was naming and claiming, but my thing was, if that's God's will for me, I'll receive it. Mm-hmm. So to me, I was speaking, but I didn't just say, well, I know I'm going, you know.
Yeah, but Pastor, if you could find a scripture on it,
yeah,
you got it.
That's the key.
You got to find a scripture on it, you got it.
The scripture says, whatsoever things you desire,
right,
when you pray,
believe that you receive. Or no good thing will
withhold
from you.
So I think you should name the scripture, whatever you're basing it on, that should be in the mix, right?
Right.
And then you say, I believe that the blessings of the Lord maketh me rich. I believe that by His stripes I'm healed.
Or no good thing will the Lord withhold from me.
Yeah, right.
I mean, that no good thing, I mean, that's a pretty general.
Well, see, the problem is that unless you qualify like that, people can call you a liar real easy because they don't understand the vital and the legal and the vital aspect. See, Christ has made all of these things ours. Actually, legally, everything that's written here is legally ours, but it's not ours in manifestations. In other words, it hasn't manifested. You know, much of it hasn't manifested in our lives. So if a person were unbeliever, if you said that I'm rich without qualifying it, you know, my God shall supply all my need according to His riches. I believe that I receive all my needs are met. I believe that all my needs are met according to His riches of glory. If you can't qualify that, people can indict you and say, you know, that person's a liar. You know, they ain't broke, they ain't got a damn to the name. And then they're going around saying all this stuff. They're just lying.
Whoa. But that's an indictment on your faith. Yeah. But personally, I mean, they call Jesus all those names. Okay. They call him a liar, you know, they call him a soothsayer. Mm-hmm. So what people bring at you, but for one who knows that things are created from the invisible, mm-hmm. from the spirit, mm-hmm. then right. naturally things that are manifested does come from the spirit.
Right. Right.
So to get something, you got to get it from the spirit.
Right.
You have to.
Okay. Now, what about this scripture? Abraham was a person that believed God, and he called the things that be not as mm-hmm. though they were. Mm-hmm. It said that he called the things that were not as they are.
He called the things that be not as they are,
as
they were.
Yeah, he called the things that be not. In other words, he says, I'm the father. He believed God. I'm the father of what? Many nations.
Right.
Yeah, he called the things that be not as though they were. Mm-hmm. But the Bible said he believed God.
Right.
You know. Okay, then when you say that, we call it the things that are, like, I am not sick when you are sick. Mm-hmm. You're calling the things that be, what? Things that are. Mm-hmm. As
not true.
Yeah.
Right, okay.
But so, that's fair.
What? Call them things that
that's,
be. Thing that be.
I mean, if I'm sick mm-hmm. and I want to be well, mm-hmm. then I have to call the things well, and things sick is not true. Mm-hmm. So in reality, my body is experiencing the sickness, but in the spirit, I'm healed. Well, so I'm calling the spirit to be manifest in my body,
right.
which is sick.
You say it, though.
It's the way you say it. It's just a little technicality the way you say it. But it's always to say, I qualify by I believe, based on the word of God, that I am all that God says I am. I have all that God says I have. You can always stand on the word of God. But you just don't arbitrarily just claim anything and just say that this is mine.
Well, but Pastor Hill, think of manufacturing, textile, engineering.
Right.
People that don't even believe in God operates in God's principles by calling things that are not as they are.
Right, yeah.
Because to be an inventor, right. you have to see right. something that's not existing.
Right.
So they're even operating in the things of God, but they just don't claim it as that, but they're operating from the principles of God.
Right. That's good. We'll just kind of point out some things to keep people out of trouble, because people always say that I'm healed, and you know, be saying that for 20 years and they're still sick.
But the truth is in the Word of God. It's not in the people. Physical being.
Yeah. Right.
So what I'm really actually saying, even though I'm sick. My belief and the truth in the Word of God is the proof that I know.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you're saying, basically.
Yeah, basically, you have to qualify with the Word of God. I'm standing on the Word of God. Let people know you're standing on the Word of God. Mm-hmm. Although it hasn't manifested, but you believe in the Word.
I'm sorry, I was going to say,
but I don't want to
be waiting for 20 years.
There you go.
Yeah, but you're alive for 20 years. You're alive.
Right now, manifestation. Well, see, I think a lot of times we as believers are sincere and we meditate, we pray and all, but we're not recipients of all that God has promised us our best, because you know, like you were saying earlier, a lot of times we haven't been taught to do all this. Mm-hmm. We grew up in church, like Sister Irene said, and we relied on the pastor to teach us the word. And, you know, when you were coming up, and nobody, well, the church I grew up in, they didn't say, you need to read, you need to study, you need to meditate and all. And, of course, I grew up in a home where that was prevalent in our home, but it wasn't stressed from the pulpit. You know, and basically everybody in the congregation was relied on the preacher. That's what we paid you to do. And, you know, if you grow up with that thinking, then you have to be deprogrammed some at some point in time. And I submit to you that it's much easier to put something in than it is to deprogram it, get it out, than to try to put something else in. So that's where a lot of believers are, you know. They've grown up with a thinking and just relying on somebody. It's because you can hear, how many times have we heard people go from church to church and say, oh, I wasn't fed at Reverend Farrell's church. I wasn't fed. You know, what did you do? Okay, and they go to Reverend Joe Blow's church. I didn't get what I needed there. And then you look up, they've gone to six different churches. Because we're not really, really, it's not really stressed that you need to program that where you feed babies. But once you grow up, you have to do some programming and feeding them yourself.
Okay, good. Now, you just hit on the third point, renewing the mind, is this. That is very important, how you renew the mind. That which caused, this is on page 2, under number 3, that which caused my subconscious process to release the grip on the old information in my belief system and assess the new information deposit there from the Word of God. That is very powerful. This is the process of renewing the mind. You got to program the Word of God into your heart with your mouth. The heart, the mouth has to feed the heart faith. And when the heart gets full of faith, full of life, full of energy, then your heart will turn around and what? Feed your mouth faith. So it's just, it's more than just confessing the Word of God one time. You got to confess it, keep confessing it until life is deposited into your spirit, until you become energized, until you become impregnated, until the Word of God becomes rhema. That's the reason why the Word of God needs to be, like Joshua said, don't let the Word of God what?
Pour out of your ground.
Thou shalt do what?
Meditate
on it, what?
Day and night.
That doesn't mean that you just be reflecting on it. And that's probably one of the main reasons why the difficulty exists today among the people of God in prayer. You seem like that many times people don't get the breakthrough they need, and they don't get that spiritual vibrancy that they really desire. It's because I think it's a matter of feeding your heart more. If you just spent a few minutes a day, now this is probably the best book we have in terms of depositing the Word of God into your spirit, because this deals with so many areas. It deals with mind-renewing scriptures. It deals with praise and thanksgiving scriptures. It deals with God's love and God's care for you. You know, when people feel that they feel inferior, they feel inadequate, they feel substandard, they feel like they're not, they don't measure up, the poor image, you know, a poor self-image of themselves, they need to reflect a lot more on God's love and God's care for them. And we got tons and tons of scripture that can build you up. And we need to meditate on various areas. If you're dealing with a self-image problem, then you need to reflect on God's love and God's care. Okay? Now, the area that I like to focus on a lot, the power and authority of the spoken word. I like to speak forth the Word of God in prayer. God's promises, His provisions, His blessings. I like to name them things. His covenant, He said He'll never break, neither will He alter the word that comes out of His mouth. That means that God is going to what? He's going to stand by His promise. Whatever He's promised, maybe you haven't received it yet, but you can really build up your what? Your confidence and elevate your belief by what? Speaking forth that in prayer. I try to think about every scripture I can think about. Sometimes I just do the authority thing, the word. Sometimes I think about the grace, everything I can think about God's willingness to release His grace on my behalf. And, you know, all of these things are very important. Then I think about who I am in Christ. And, okay, the ministry of reconciliation. There are scriptures that will build you up in those particular areas. But if you never meditate those areas, you will have very little desire to deal with people that are lost. That's really amazing how what you meditate on determines the direction of your life. It creates the world or the environment that you are going to experience. So whatever you want to be more fervent, more built up, more established, because confession actually helps to establish us in faith. That's the reason why we do it. So don't feel that you're wasting time. You know, when you're in prayer, that's the reason why many times I like for people to come to prayer, because we're so busy. We're running, got so many responsibilities and so many cares. We're caught up in so many different things. And sometimes you're going to find out that your time in prayer is going to be some of your most profitable times with the Lord. Because many times at home you'll read, but most times you're not going to read out. Have I prophesied? You're going to be what? Quiet? Right? And you're not going to be able to get out of that what you get when you what? Release these words. So, I'm thinking that prayer has made my life. I mean, that is my life. Well, when I pray, I try to pray in the Spirit as much as I can. And then the Lord begins to, you know, He does this with all of us, that we begin to release words. Amen. Talk about His covenant, His faithfulness, His love, His grace, His righteousness, you know, who I am in Christ. Whatever comes to you, and that's the advantage of meditating a whole lot of things, because when you get in that spirit realm, these things begin to what? Come to you. And all you have to do is what? Speak them out. And as you begin to speak them out, if you speak them out in scripture, in word, what happens is that you get to a certain point, and then the tongues are going to what? Go up to another level. You're going to begin to experience different types of prayer languages, singing in the Spirit. It's going to motivate you. It's going to energize you. It's going to really turn you on big time. Amen. So I just want to encourage you to take out your meditation book. If you want to go to the area on healing, deliverance through the Word of God, all of these things are in this meditation book. And of course, this book here is great for new converts and for old converts to 21 Freedom Truths. You know, I think, y'all tell me whether I'm right or not, once we do these things for a while, then we have a tendency to kind of what? Get away from them. Right? Get tired of them. Now, just like who I am in Christ. Well, that's a good declaration. How often should we be saying things like that?
All the time.
All the time. A declaration of victory over sin. A declaration of deliverance. See, man will know it when you automatically begin to respond out of your own heart. Things like this become secondhand and nobody have to tell you. Y'all meditate this week. Y'all get back into your meditation books, babies. So that's what mind renewing is, and so that's what we're reading about. Okay, this enables me to have an automatic. This is renewing the mind under number 3. So without thinking it through carefully, it becomes a lifestyle. Is what I have chosen to believe, and my belief system has now released this old junk, the old lustful man, blind man, and now I am a new man. Because I have received new information, I'm now locked into a new way of believing. So renewing the mind is this: you're doing that which will cause you to respond internally, automatically, to the Word of God. Most people have to consciously think and do things for God. Because it's a conscious thing with them, they have to remember to pray. read the word, share the word, make godly choices. God wants us to flow so with him that you don't have to put forth a lot of conscious effort. It becomes second nature to you, so to speak. Okay, so how do we arrive at this mind renewing that we're speaking about? It's basically doing the things that we have shared tonight. And I just want to encourage brothers. Now, let's talk it over. Women and brothers, we haven't prayed for 30 days. And the best way to